diff.
Oh no, I could see your hair. I love it.
It's nice, right?
That's a good look for you, man.
My wife got this new shampoo. I put it. I washed my hair the last night. Woke up like this. Yeah.
Your wife is like, yeah. That's a keeper. That's why she's your wife. Yeah.
Exactly. She knew. She had it the whole time. I could have been doing this the whole time.
Yeah.
But it's time. So, how are you, man?
I'm good. A little exhausted, but, you know, I got my coffee and I spiked it with, like, some vodka, so.
That's dope. I got some white wine. Cheers.
Nice. Cheers.
I've never done vodka in the coffee.
I usually don't, but I just grabbed the first thing I saw threw it in.
Yeah, so Joey's a freaking champ. He's been up all night. 100 gold. Thanks for subbing. I think that's Necro again just handing out subs. It's going to be that kind of day for Necro. Necro is a wonderful part of the family we have here on my channel, and he's definitely probably in the lead for most subs gifted on my page. He is a very generous, kind-hearted soul.
Oh, we love you, Necro.
Hell yeah. So he's been up all night. You didn't sleep. Been doing a bunch of stuff for his wife. Been just killing it, and still was like, yeah, I'll come on the stream today. So let's give a round of applause. Round of applause for Joey, everybody. That's super tight.
Yeah, boy. There actually
should be an applause button now. I added an applause button on the right of the screen. You can probably see it. So if any time during the stream you want to clap, you can now. That's fun.
That's so sick.
Necro's got 10 more subs, and he'll hit the 1,400 mark. That's insane. You know what to
nice.
Do. You know what to do, bro. You know what to do. So let's talk about your band. Let's talk about your band, Varsity.
Yeah, let's talk about it.
First of all. All right. What the fuck you guys have against vowels?
I don't think we have anything all against right. it. It's kind of, you know, it was just something we had to do. Yeah. Kind of, I guess.
You know, I secretly have always wished that I was a band that, like, was a vowel-less name. I like that. Like, or, well, like, what? The replacement of, like, V, like Paris, or, like, stuff like that. I think that shit's tight.
I mean, it's sick, but I can't honestly take any credit for dropping the vowels, because it was never, like, our intention to do that.
Yeah.
It was kind of something that was forced on us, so. Yeah, man. Yo, this is the funniest thing ever. So when we first started being a band a couple of years ago, we started picking up steam, and I found out there was like another Varsity, but they were like an indie band.
But it's the Varsity, isn't it?
No, they were just called Varsity.
Oh.
Yeah. And so I obviously, like, I hired a lawyer because I'm like, hey, you know, I want to get the name situated. And our lawyer pretty much was like, yeah, you know, they don't own the copyright or the trademark to it, so we can take, but I'll have to get them to take down, like, all the music and stuff like that. And I looked up the band, and it turns out they had, like, millions of plays, like, throughout, like, online and stuff like that. And so I just didn't want to ruin them, so I just decided, I was like, hey, you know what, we'll just drop the vowels and just keep whatever, so.
Fuck vowels anyways. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, man, no one needs those. They're not important.
No. Just a real quick thank you to Necro for dropping that 10. That takes you to the 1,400 mark. 1,400 subs on this channel. I love you, you kind son of a bitch. It would have been better, back to Varsity. It would have been dope if you were like, yeah, like, you guys were like, yeah, fuck vowels. But then also you, like, held to it where you didn't even speak them or write them or sing them. That could be hard. That could be hard.
Could you imagine trying to sing a song and leaving the vowels out of the words?
That's called dedication. You're learning a new language. You're just speaking without vowels.
Technically, I feel like everyone might be able to do that when they're drunk. When you're drunk, you pretty much leave all the vowels out of your words anyway.
Yeah, I think that just kind of happens. Yeah, it's just a natural acquired drunk language.
Yeah, so I would just have to get drunk every time. Every time.
Yeah.
It'd be on point.
That's tight. Yeah, dude, well, that's good. I mean, Varsity's a tight band name. I think that I have one of the dumbest band names on earth, but I'm also
really
band, so I'm different. But things sound cool when you're in high school.
Wait. Why do you think it's a dumb band name?
That's just silly. I mean, it's original. There's no, like, other Atreyu. There is an Atreyu shoe company that just came out, but we have had conversations with them and they're very friendly, so we're letting it happen. We're coexisting, but I mean, it's definitely, we're not going to run into that, and it's definitely, like, memorable, but, like, everyone, it just leaves open that question, like, oh, so do you guys like the Never Ending Story in every interview ever? It'd be like, oh, varsity, like, were you on varsity? Like, what sport did you play? Like, oh, it's just a name, dude.
We actually have gotten that question.
You're like, no, none of us play sports.
Yeah.
I was on varsity chess.
Yeah, I was just like, hey, yeah, we actually don't play. Yeah, we don't play any sports. I mean, I used to. Sometimes I want to lie about things like that.
Yeah.
When they ask, like, hey, oh my God, so is it varsity because you played, you know, varsity? I literally just want to say, yeah, I play like varsity football.
Just start answering with all state, bro. All state.
All state. I almost made it pro, but then, you know, band is life. So.
You want to check tape? Check tape. I went all state.
I decided to do this. I can't imagine if, like, I actually did play sports.
Yeah, I mean, people ask me my whole life to play sports. My whole life, because I'm a big dude. Even, like, if I was the skinniest my body gets, I'm still a big frame. So, at my whole high school career, I was like, hey, son, you going to play football? Hey, son, you should go out for baseball. Like, no, I'm good.
Yeah, like, sports are cool, but it's just not my thing, you know?
Yeah, I just didn't care. I'm sure I have a spot on my shirt. That's cool.
Yeah.
Didn't see that until. You know why? Because usually it's the hair that probably made the spot stick out. So just a little bit more grungy. It actually just goes with the whole outfit.
Yeah. Well, you wouldn't be able to play sports with that hairdo anyway.
No. Well, nowadays, you know, you got mad football players like braids or like long ass hair. You know, I could do some fancy shit. I could fuck with it.
Oh, yeah.
I could do it.
You could probably, you know, what you could probably do. You could probably be the first crossover guy with like fashion and football.
Yeah. Like wearing like some gold ass chains and like some fresh footwear. Maybe like some ripped in the knees football pants.
Wait, why has no one done that yet?
I don't think they're allowed. Huh? I don't think they're allowed. See, I was that dude though. Back in like elementary school, I did play basketball, and I was like, "Yo, can I have, can I make a basketball like warm up suit?" And they were like, "Yeah, but you'll be the only person on the team with one." I was like, "I don't care." And they were like, "Sure," but like I always wanted to just do dumb shit that was stupid. I still like to do dumb shit with stupid. That's my band. But I don't think it's actually gone away. Like, guys, you got this idea. They're like, oh, my God. My management. Whoa, did you see that?
Oh, nice.
Magic. Magic.
It's magic.
Yep, that's awesome. All right, so how long have you guys been around? How long have you guys been a band?
I think we've been a band for, I want to say, 5 years, I think. Something like that. I'm not too sure. Could be five or so.
You guys are from New York, yeah?
Yes. So originally me and my bassist are from New York. The rest of the guys are like Pennsylvania and around like the parts like Long Island, stuff like that.
Cool. So the Northeast.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's dope. So I mean, even 5 years, that's not a long time. And you guys, I mean, is this kind of is this you guys' first release of Spine Farm?
Yeah, this is our like very first one.
And did you guys have other releases before this, just like in some independent shit, or just kind of like play the single game, or how'd you guys roll that?
Yeah, it's a really crazy story. So we were with so I started the band by myself. It's just like it was a solo project and then just turned into a band. We were with other labels before and never released anything under them ever.
Crazy.
Yeah, because the labels just, you know, were shit. So we just, you know, like, hey, I'm leaving now.
Yeah.
And just kind of did we were signed, but did independent things in between. And then we were been touring, and Spine Farm was like, hey, we want to do all these things with you. And so, sure, why not?
they actually are good at keeping promises. Like, they're not a lot. I mean, we've been on a handful of labels, all of which told us a lot of things and then wouldn't do them. But they usually put their money where their mouth is. Like, for the most part, they'll do everything they can. I mean, especially with radio. I mean, my other band, Hell or High Water, it doesn't really matter where you exist, where you existed before in the world. You start a new band. You're starting a new band. So we had to start from scratch.
Yeah.
Especially at the time, like, Atreyu wasn't really doing shit. So, like, there was a lot of radio and a lot of shit that people were just like, nah, we want Atreyu. They didn't give a shit. But, like, they fucking hustled for us at radio. And, like, and I want to get to that. I want to talk about the whole Octane thing. I mean, y'all have been the number one played song on Octane for 2 weeks.
Yeah, but 2 weeks.
I got an issue with that because we're number five, bro. That's just not.
Dude, you know what's funny about that? I looked on the list of bands that like were on that list, and I honestly thought it was like a mistake. I'm like, there's no way. This is bullshit. There's no way we're number one here.
This is something that's rad about Octane. They give newer bands a shot. You know what I mean? They will put they will do the whole Octane Accelerator thing. They'll play the shit out of you. And if it sticks, they'll keep doing it. If it doesn't, they gave it the shot. But they will actually give that shot, which is unlike literally anything else. Radio stations that are just like testing new and up and coming bands to see if they work. Like you got played like 60 something times or some shit last week on Octane. That's crazy.
Yeah, I saw that and I thought it was insane too. Like yeah. I wouldn't listen to my band, but I'm glad other people want to listen to us.
No, that's tight. That's awesome, man. Congrats on that. It's definitely a huge thing. Have you guys seen just kind of from? I mean, I know it's decently recent, but have you guys been seeing kind of a little bit of a wave of kind of influx of, you know, like your socials and your streams and stuff from that Octane success?
Oh yeah, man. We were, I think before this whole like Octane thing or just before like the releases, we were at like 20K monthly listeners on Spotify. We're almost at 100 now.
Crazy.
All of our plays went up. So people found us on Octane for Massive, which is a song up there. And then they started going back and listening to our older stuff and everything started going up.
Crazy.
Yeah. It's insane. Awesome. Like I've never actually like paid attention to that crowd of people who listens to Octane. Cause I just always thought like we were a scene band and now that we're like on the radio, it's that whole crowd is like super dedicated and super different.
For sure. And then they find something and they fucking hold on to it, bro. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
Well, I'm trying something. Someone in my chat just said something and it was a good point. They were like, I've had a lot of guests on this show. Most of them have all been like friends of mine, more established mm-hmm. artists, more established bands. And someone was like, why don't you play one of their songs so that we can hear it and ask like questions about the band. I was like, that's a great idea.
Oh.
I'm gonna look up one of your videos.
Oh, nice.
What's the video?
You should. All right, if you're gonna look up a video, look up Shameless. I know everyone's gonna like Shameless because there's a hot girl in it, and that always sells the song. As long as you have a hot girl, it sells the song. The song could suck, but it doesn't matter because there's a hot girl in it.
So my first, I'm gonna give like my first kind of opinion of the band. The one of the things that really kind of that struck me at first was the fact that you guys are like a heavy band, but at the same time, like your voice is not heavy band voice at all.
No,
you know, like you are very much. I mean, I would even go as far as saying like you're a pop singer, like you have a pop voice, and I think that that's wonderful. That's kind of like my favorite shit when bands don't sound like you mix the shit that you wouldn't think, and I think that's fucking really cool.
Yeah, I think it's just really random because like I'm actually not a metal singer. I didn't grow up listening to like metal. Like I listened to like Michael Jackson and Usher and all those other things when I was growing up. But then I got into metal because I started playing guitar and I just loved writing it.
Yeah.
And that it kind of became this thing where I was just writing random heavy riffs and singing over it. So
for sure. See, that's dope. I think that's fucking cool. I'm excited for people to hear this. I'm trying to get this to work real fast before I switch it over so that it looks correct.
Yeah, I have no plan for any of the music I write. It's just all the most random things in the world.
I mean, that's my whole. I mean, our career, obviously, we're a specific. I mean, sort of genre, I guess. But at the same time, we're also like we do whatever the fuck we want. So
it's always been
that same thing where it's just like just enjoying yourself and making art, you know.
Well, you guys always put out like bangers. So
thank you, bro. We try. That's the goal.
It's just like constant bangers.
That is the goal, my friend.
Yeah, you're probably lying. And you guys are probably the type of band that don't try and then it's just a banger. And then it's like, all right, well I guess I'll just, you know, just kill myself. Just end my career right now.
I mean, but that's just what we like. You know what I'm saying? That's just what we like. I like fucking pop choruses. I like huge sounding songs. I like all that shit. So it's kind of one of those things where it's like, that's what we want to do. That's what I want to write, you know?
I like it, man. I've always liked you guys, though.
Oh, thank you, man. I appreciate that. I'm almost got this video sorted.
Oh, almost.
I'm almost a grown up.
We.
That's good enough.
Are we ever really grown ups?
No. So they won't see you. They'll hear you, but they'll see me. But really, I mean, this wig. That's all they need to see. But I'm gonna play. This is Varsity Shameless for y'all, so y'all can know who I'm talking to. Go on and bury me. Convulsing like a fiend on the floor. She says I'm the one, but this isn't fun. She fooled me once, now she's coming for blood. Bury me. Take the darkest parts of me. Just for the thrill, I'm hypnotized by her eyes. When she moves, I'm alive. She's crazy, but she's on mine. But I can't take anymore. Convulsing like a fiend on the floor. She says I'm the one, but this isn't fun. She fooled me once, now she's coming for blood. Take the darkest parts of me. That shit was tight.
Hey.
So now you guys know. Now you guys know what we're dealing with here. You know who I'm talking to. You know what the band is. hell yeah. Reminds me of, someone said it reminds me of a heavier version of a band, of Amorosa. You ever heard of Amorosa?
Yeah.
That dude kind of has that kind of pop vibe. That's dope. Pretty sick vocal mix. It does. Yeah, everyone's like, I can definitely hear that Michael Jackson influence.
Dude, I love Michael Jackson to death.
I mean, who doesn't though?
Yeah, that was like the first guy like I ever got into when it came to like singing.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, is like, it's funny because I like grew up on like punk rock. Obviously, I always like everyone always knows Michael Jackson, but don't get into Michael Jackson until later. So I grew up on, I wish that I would have stayed in band in high school and listened to like pop singers when I was young. Because I would have started listening to like the best. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you know what it is? I think my mom kind of she always loved music, but she never did anything with it or any or, you know, ever pursued it. And when I was younger, she would make me she would funny story, she would go into the living room like after work and she would get really drunk and she would listen to music. She'd blast it and she'd make me dance with her
That's tight.
all like all night. And so I started, you know, hearing the same songs over and over and over. And it was she used to play like a lot of like Frank Sinatra and like Barry White and like really old school stuff and then
Yeah.
Michael Jackson and Prince. And I started getting into singing because of that. And then I just one day I just fell in love and that was it. I was like, I'm never gonna do anything else because everything else is crap.
Yeah, once you start being in a band, even if you're like fucking broke and struggling, it's still fucking awesome.
Dude, I tell people that all the time. They're like, oh, you're on a label, man. Like, you must be rich. It's like, I wish, dude.
It's not the fucking 90s, bro.
Yeah, like we out here making scraps. Like, we ain't making nothing. You fall in love with this, and then that's it. You don't want to do anything else.
That's why a lot of bands don't last. You know what I mean? That's why a lot of bands come out, they last a few years, and then it's gone because before they can even actually make an impact or get to a place of like comfortability at all, they're over it. That's too much. It's too much
I
for them.
think that's like a personal thing though, 'cause I know people who had opportunities to do stuff and they were like, oh, well, there's no money, I'm leaving. And to me, that's like, all right, you fake. Like,
But you have to think long game too. Like being in a band is not about tomorrow. Being in a band is about 5 years from now, 10 years from now.
yeah.
There's decisions that you make that aren't always, they don't always seem great for right now. You have no many time how many times that we've been like, oh, we can go tour Europe, like in the beginning, and been like, yo, we have an opportunity to go tour Europe. It's probably gonna cost us money. And we're like, yeah, let's go. Or
Yeah.
like we don't know if you're gonna make money. It's like, yeah, let's go. Like you just have
Yeah,
to think long game. You can't think quick with the band. Being in a band is not a quick thing. It's not a quick jump. Bands will just, most bands, 99% of bands, they'll just get big. You know what I mean?
it's weird, man. Like, especially now, like I've just learning this and everything, it's kind of like no decision is ever the right decision because you'll never know whether it's right or wrong anyway.
No, you just
You just
jump.
have to kind of you just jump in and you work.
For sure.
But you know, most people don't kind of get that.
I think it's funny, my wife's always been like, she's always been like, oh, like so much shit just rolls off your back. Like shit doesn't affect you. Like bad shit happens or like whatever. And you just kind of rolls off your back. You're like, okay, whatever. Like next thing. And I'm like, I think it's just because how it's like my, what I'm from being in a band. Because bad shit happens all the time. You're just like, okay, next thing. Like my Hell or High Water was on one of our first tours in 2011. We did the Uproar tour, like a big summer
Okay.
festival. With like Avenged Sevenfold and 3 Days Grace and a bunch of bands. And we got in an accident on the way out in our RV. We got in an accident. We backed up in a KOA like 2 weeks into the tour and ripped the back of our RV off. We backed up into like a pole. We drilled it and taped it back on. And then we got run off the road by a semi at like 5 o'clock
Jesus.
in the morning and crashed again. Not didn't tip, thankfully. My wife had like a huge like freaking blood thing on her hip and like her head was bleeding and like our RV was fucking toast, like toast. We literally bought a new trailer on tour, somehow taped our fucking literally taped and screwed our RV back together. The bay doors were gone, like all this shit, and people were like, what are you doing here still? And we're like, what are we gonna do? Go home? Like, what's gonna happen if we
Yeah.
go home? Nothing.
What are we supposed to do?
And we're here
Go
doing these
home and do
shows.
nothing?
Oh, and our transmission went all in one tour, in one summer, all that happened. But we didn't go
Dude, that was
home.
one thing?
That was one summer. That was one tour.
Oh,
That was for that was like that was like
Jesus.
a September. That was like a September, October. Yeah.
Dude, we haven't had bad luck like that. We've had some crazy van troubles like on our tours, but never anything like that. I mean, our van I think has died. Our old van died once on every tour we went on. So,
Yeah, I mean that's normal shit though. That's but it just happens. You just kind of keep going. The best part was everyone's like, you need to go home. We're like, nah. So we were hustling, and that tour was really good for us. It was like our kind of debut, and all that shit happened, and somehow we still came home and made money. And we're like, that's why we didn't go home.
Well,
like
I gotta be honest though, like it's kind of weird sometimes too, because I know things happen sometimes on tour, and a lot of people, the first thing is always like, oh, that messed up, go home.
Yeah.
And you could go home, but there's always the, well, what if that's the wrong decision? What if by going home you make everything worse, and so you stay?
Yeah, absolutely. You have to.
Yeah, you just gotta
stay the course. I think being in a band is essentially just getting kicked in the balls and just getting back up over and over again. That's essentially what it is, man. But
yeah, you get kicked in the balls a lot. This industry is kind of, they have like a fetish for kicking bands in the balls.
Yeah, you gotta pay for it. Like, pretty, you want to do well? You're gonna pay great. For this.
Crazy.
Yeah, shit's nuts, man. But but you guys are, no pun intended. But you guys are actually, though, you guys are in good hands. Like, as are we. I think Spine Farm is, like I said, we've been a band for 20 plus years and been a part of a couple labels, and they're the first label that is not just like a bunch of suits, and they're actually just like people that care, and they're like super collaborative, and just like they're into it, man. They're into fucking the bands they signed.
I've actually liked that out of them. They don't feel like suits. Like, they feel really human. To the point where even though they're the label, I literally just text them to fuck with them all the time now, like just to bother them. And I'm like, all right, how many people actually get to say it's like, oh yeah, I just fuck with everyone at my label. I don't actually care, kind of thing.
Yeah, because they don't care. Like, they're like, they're not gonna like get mad and like do something shitty to you. Because they all come from our same place. I don't know like what scene you grew up in, but like, dude, I've known the people like Darren and Tim and all those people at the label. Like, I've known all those fools since like they were going to hardcore shows and like worked for hardcore labels. Like, they've been seeing Atreyu play for fucking years and years and years and years and years since we were all young kids. You know what I mean? Jesus. That's crazy.
Yeah, I don't know anyone. I don't know anyone at the label.
Oh, really?
Like, at all. No, dude, I didn't even know they were interested in us. They called, they emailed my manager while we were on tour in December of last year. It was like December of last year. We were getting off tour, and they emailed him, and then January and February came around, and we were back on tour. Most random thing ever. I went to it was a While She Sleeps show, and I met Tim and Darren and stuff. They asked me to come to the office the next week, and then Corona happened, and they're like, "Well, we're gonna pick you guys up. That's what we want to do." And I'm like, "Sick! I had no idea you guys even knew who the hell we were."
That's funny as hell.
Yeah, they were super random. We were talking to like some other labels before them, and then Spine Farm just came, and I didn't like what anything else that anyone else had to say besides the guys at Spine Farm. So, yeah.
No, that's
dope. Dude, I got some really shitty advice before Spine Farm, which is crazy.
Yeah.
Dude, I actually had one label literally tell me straight up, like, you'd be more successful if you weren't heavy and you just copied what Omarosa did. I literally had them tell me that over the phone. I was like, sick.
Yeah, but my band's not called Omarosa. They already exist.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, dude. Like, if you're just someone else, what's the point?
I mean, in most cases, that doesn't pan out. You know what I mean?
No, there's no longevity behind that, behind copying.
No, you're better off. That's what someone asked earlier. Like, I think you might have answered. Someone else in your band, I think, is on here too. But if your guys' style was like predetermined, or was it discussed, or did it just kind of happen?
It just kind of happens, man. Like, I pick up a guitar, I start writing riffs, and then if I like a riff, I just keep going, and then I just sing over it at the end.
Yeah.
And then whatever we have at the end of it, like the song, we bring it to a producer and we rewrite it and we tighten it up, and then that's just it. Nothing is, there's no plan, there's no nothing for anything that I do. I wish there was, but
no. I mean, we're the same. We've written our last two records, like, where every day we go into the studio and be like, cool, like, what song are we writing today? What are we gonna write about?
Yeah.
We write a song that day in the studio in like a few hours, track it, that's the record. You know what I mean?
Dude, it's kind of better that way. I also I'm not a I don't know if you're like this, but I can't write my lyrics down or anything like that. So I can't write them down and come up with a melody. I have to be in the booth and I freestyle everything I do.
It's like the Jay-Z of the rock world.
Maybe not at that level, but kind of. Like, I literally, I'll have a couple of words, And I'll tell my producer, like, hey, could you loop this like over and over? And I'll just start growing with stuff. And I'm like, that's the one.
That makes sense. A lot of, I mean, I always write melody first. I'll always just come up with a melody, and there'll be like some phonetic shit in there to fill the gap. And a lot of times that'll spark a word, or that'll spark like an idea that will turn into lyrics. I'm the same.
Yeah, I do that. Like, I'll have like a word, and I'm like, all right, well, I don't have a melody, so just play it on repeat a bunch of times, and I'll come up with something. That's how tight. Most of Shameless was actually written like that. Shameless was just that breakdown, and we wrote that in the studio in like, I think it was like 2 or 3 hours.
Yeah.
And then my producer was like, hey, so you got lyrics? I was like, no, but I got melodies. So yeah. I've been looping shit over and over and over in my head. And I just started singing it.
That's tight. I mean, at the end of the day, it's funny. Like, we always have this joke where it's like, process doesn't matter. Like, it doesn't matter how long it took you to write a song. It doesn't matter how much pain you went through or how much fucking agony you did writing the song. It doesn't matter if it took you weeks or it took you an hour. It doesn't matter. It matters if people connect to it. That's the only thing that matters. Like, we learned that kind of halfway in, where it's like, oh, but like, dude, I spent fucking 4 hours getting this guitar tone. That's like,
yeah.
Do you think anyone's going to hear what you hear? No. And you're going to be happy, which ultimately you have to be happy with what you release. But like, it doesn't matter how long it takes to write a song. Some of our best songs have been written in fucking an hour. The Time Is Now was one of our most streamed songs of all time. I had an idea. I went in the studio. Was like, I got this idea. Give me 30 minutes. Went, put down the rough. The band was like, this is dope. We finished it, and it was done. Like, in 2 hours.
Yeah, dude. I've said the same exact thing. Like, sometimes I'll sit here, and I'll try to think of the most intricate guitar thing, and then I'll just realize no one's going to hear that. No one cares. Yeah. It should just be about the song and not whatever I'm doing on the song, you know, or, like, whatever I put behind it. Yeah. Most people don't listen to that anyway.
No. No, absolutely not. Necro just said something too. He's like, I feel like most of the like studio work is where 90% of the magic happens. That's where all my magic happens. Like, I thrive in an atmosphere where there was someone behind a desk that can control any sound that I want to happen like that. And there's other brains and energy in the room to bounce off of. And it's like, bam, 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 song. Like, that's where I thrive. Rather than just sitting in a room by myself and like writing whatever, I'll write riffs or I'll write a chorus if it comes to me. But I rarely sit down and go, okay, today I'm going to write music. It's like, if it comes, it comes, and that's just it. And then you just kind of build it, you know?
Nah, dude, it's exactly the same. Like, I'll sit at home and I'll write stuff, but I'm always just like, these are demos. But when I'm in the studio, it's like my brain, like, turns on, and everything just starts to come out.
Absolutely. So I feel like studio is, like, the atmosphere is important. Like, if you're in a fucking studio that you don't like, you're uncomfortable, it's just not going to work. Like,
oh, yeah, 100%.
John Feldman, the producer we've worked with now 3 times, like, his house is just something about its magic. Something about him is magic. So it's like, we keep going back because it just works, bro.
What's it like working with him?
He's like if you took lightning and caffeine and made it into a human being. He is the most, like, bright, energetic, positive human I think I've ever met. He's always just like ready to go, always inspired, always just like yeah. He's very much like, he's so his own human, you know what I mean? Like, his day is mapped out. He does the same shit every day. It's like, he gets up at like 6, he does his like exercise bike, he meditates, he does yoga, he goes down the studio, he goes, he gets breakfast with his kids, then he goes to the trainer, he does boxing or works out with his trainer, then he comes back, he's back in the studio, then he goes to this, whatever, then he goes to his meeting. It's like Jesus. His life is just going, he's always working so on many things. But he's just like a fucking ray of light, you know what I mean? And his influence is just like, you feel it, you know what I mean? And then, I mean, you walk in the house and it's like every wall is plastered with fucking plaques, and you're like, yeah, I'm like, a lot of good shit's happened here. Like, a lot of good, it just, all of that energy seeps into you, you know?
Gotcha. But, yeah. See, I've actually thought of like what I would feel like if I got to work with him. Cause he's like one of the producers that I've always been like, I would kill to work with this guy. Like, at least once in my career.
Yeah. He's great. He's a fantastic writer too. And I mean, he's just like, the dude loves music, and he's the same dude where he's like, song is king. That's all that matters. Is the song great? He'll be like, I think that sucks, or that doesn't suck. You know what I mean? He's very, like, honest, whatever. And he's like, he's there to do one thing. He's there to fucking write great songs, you know?
Our producer was like that, Andrew. He pretty much, so we recorded the EP and, like, some other stuff with Andrew Bayless.
Yeah.
And he was like that. So I would go in with demos, and he'd love like the vocal melodies I was doing. But a lot of the times, if he didn't like an instrumental, he told me shut up. He's like, dude, he's like, this part sucks. Like,
yeah,
we need to scrap this. Like, it should be about the song, not about like the skill level in a part or a drum fill or any of this other stuff. Has to be about the song. And working with him was like absolutely amazing, because this guy wakes up, and the moment he wakes up, puts a guitar in his hands and just starts going.
Yeah, same.
I love it.
Feldy writes a song every day.
Yeah, this guy. That was actually what we did. So we just recorded again with him, and we get there, and he's like, "All right, we're gonna do one song a day. We're here for 36 days, one song a day, every day." And I'm like, "Oh crap!"
Straight up, dude. We started our most recent. I mean, it's not out yet, but our most recent effort, I'll call it, in January. We were in the studio for 2 weeks. Of that 2 weeks, we were actually in the studio for 12 days, and we did 16 songs in 12 days.
Jesus.
It was fucking bonkers, dude. Like, and they're all good. They all made the record. They all made it.
Dude, that's incredible. That is incredible. I always get scared, like, writing stuff, and then do you like ever leave the studio scared of like what you're gonna hear back?
A lot of times I forget, because with Felty too, he's not like huge on like sending reference like mixes for you, like, because it's not done. He doesn't want you to like get connected to like demoitis or get connected to something that's not finished. So a lot of times we'll do stuff and we don't hear it for like weeks, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, I remember this song. And it's cool, because most of the time you're like, this song's still tight. Like, that's fantastic.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, I just had that recently. So we recorded in August, and I just started hearing stuff back now that we recorded, and I forgot completely about – I even forgot that we, like, recorded all these things. And I started hearing it back, and I'm like, oh, crap, that's right. We did more music. But I forgot what the hell we did, so now I'm terrified. I'm like, oh, man, was it even good? Like, was it – is he going to send me back a bunch of crap and be like, your band sucks, bro?
Dude, my wife just commented on here. She's like – she says, I get scared of demos. I'll come home and I'm like, yo, this shit's fucking dope. You want to hear whatever? She's like, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear this, because I don't know what you're hearing. And it's, I don't hear the things that you hear because they're not there yet. So like, you know what's happening, but I don't know what's happening. So she'll hear demos and she's just like, I don't think I like this song. And then I'll play her the real thing. And she's like, oh yeah, okay, I like this song.
Yeah, it's scary, man. Like, there's always times where like, I would want to, like, my friends will be over and I'd be like, damn, you know, I could just play this demo like on my monitors really quickly. But then I start to think about it and I'm like, maybe they won't get what I was trying to do because the effect or the part isn't on it yet or something like that. So
for sure, man,
it's weird. I did a ballad on the something recently, and we just used a loop. It's just like one loop continuously for like 3 minutes. And the point was to get all the vocals done, and then we were going to scrap the loop and rewrite like the whole piano and everything else from scrap. And I love it, but every time I want to show it to somebody, I'm just like, they're only going to hear the loop for 3 minutes straight, and they're going to be like, bro, there's nothing here. This sucks. So,
dude,
you know,
that's funny. Yeah,
tough life.
It's true. You can't do it. That's what, like, a lot of times too. It's, people are like, no, play it for me. I was like, hey, trust me, it's not going to. It's like showing someone a painting that's not done yet.
That's exactly what it's like.
Yeah.
I didn't realize the light turned off. We have like it started raining here. It started like storming really bad.
Oh yeah.
And so like, And so like everything in my house is just like flickering and stuff. And I'm like, oh, nice. And then I just look at the screen and I'm like, oh, look, my light is off.
I thought you just were like feeling a spooky vibe. I was just going to let you run with it.
Nah, dude. My house gets too dark.
Yeah.
My house is like the haunting kind of dark. Like, it's just, it's insane.
Do you live in like an old ass apartment building?
So the building looks like an old school church, the apartments are brand new, which is what's crazy about it. Everyone that comes here walks through the front of the building and is like, dude, what the hell? Like, you live here? And then they see the apartment. They're like, oh, wait, okay. I don't get it. It's
funny.
Weird, man. It's super weird. But
I feel like New York is full of that, though. Like, you can't judge anything by the outside of anything in New York.
No, dude. New York is so random. Everything is like so all over the place. Like, you honestly can't judge a goddamn thing, because you'll do it, but then you'll think one thing looks one way, and you'll see it from the inside and you're like, oh, well, I was wrong.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
It's a New York thing. It's the same way with food.
It's a New York thing.
Great. most of the food looks great, and then you eat it, and you're like, it tastes like crap. You got to go to like the really low budget spots to get good food.
You got to go to the shitholes to get good food. Yes, babe, wine. Dude. My wife is in the chat. She says, babe, wine? Yes. Yes, please, wine.
Yes.
My wife is the shit. She'll be in here in a sec.
Nice.
But, oh, hi, Julia. Julia, our bass player's wife. She's like, I like demos, but then y'all change them again later, and I grew to like that specific thing in the demo, and then I can't unhear it when it's not there anymore. I'm like, that's true. Yeah,
dude, isn't that crazy? Sometimes demos change, and people that happen to hear the demo like a specific thing, and then it's not there.
Yeah,
and they don't get why it's not there, so they hate you for it.
And you're like,
but it's not your fault.
You're not in the fucking band. That's why it's not there. Yeah. Shut up.
I love that, bro. People are like, bro, no, change it back for me, and I'm like, I can't just do that. Just fucking do that. That's crazy.
Hold on,
ludicrous, bonkers.
Hold on, I'll be right back.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, I forgot I locked it. So the psychos didn't get in. You like my hair? Oh, look at it. Yeah, she got it now. That's tight.
Hi.
This is my
That's
wife,
so
Ashley.
Sick. Nice to meet you. Hello. It's nice to meet you too.
This fool sounds like Michael Jackson. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thanks, babe. I need my wig
elegant?
Back. We just high fived the wig back to you. Like, we high fived the wig back on my head. Did you see that?
That was magic.
Straight
that
up.
Was crazy.
We are meant to be. Love you. That shit was tight. I'm really missing.
She said it was elegant.
She said your voice is elegant.
No, I think she said this interview was elegant. She said something was elegant.
Oh.
I think it was the interview. I've never had anyone call me elegant.
It's
ever,
not really.
So.
It's not usually in the lexicon that people use for me.
Yeah, that's never a thing. So I feel really good right now. Like, I feel fancy.
That's tight. You dude.
I should probably switch from, like, vodka to, like some fine whiskey soon.
Yeah, maybe
just
like
to make it a little
some,
more
like
elegant.
Some cognac or a nice champagne.
A nice...
Are you a cocktail?
I'm probably not gonna do that, but it'd be nice to think of it.
Are you a cocktail? You're like, I'm probably gonna take a nap after this, fool. But are you a cocktail guy or like a wine guy? What's your what's your bev of choice?
Hold
on. How old are you?
You know,
how old are you? Let me answer this question for you.
33.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's a tough age.
Is it?
Well, I mean, if you're 33, like you've gotten out of the certain youthful phases of alcohol. So you're probably like, what are you into? What are you into?
So I drink everything straight now. I'm literally like, I'll drink like tequila straight, Jameson straight. Anything you give me, it's just straight.
Yeah. See, I get that. I'm a whiskey dude straight. I can't like, I can only drink like at least decent or good bourbon straight. I can't do tequila. I hate shots. I can't do like shots. I can't do vodka straight. But I'm like simple. I'm like a vodka soda guy. I fuck with a margarita. I fuck with a bourbon straight. I drink a lot. Me and my wife drink a lot of wine.
Well, wine is good for you.
It is. It's good. It's got antioxidants. It's good for the heart.
Yeah.
It's good for sanity.
That's that's very, very true.
That's a good question.
It's amazing.
Everyone I've talked to has been obviously on during this whole pandemic. New York has been more fucking crazy than I think anywhere in the country. Like, where's your head been at? How crazy has your like lockdown been and that whole experience?
I think at first, all right, it's kind of weird because everyone thinks it's crazy. It's not actually that crazy, which is really weird. I think it's like, it's just all media bullshit. But at first when it happened, it was kind of crazy. Everyone was, you know, afraid and buying up all the toilet paper. And, you know, locked in her house and stuff like that. Which, you know, obviously I didn't know what the hell was going on. So I'm like, well, I guess, you know, I'll just stay home and stuff like that. Lately it's been like a lot more like loose. So like, you know, people go outside, but there's more people wearing masks and everything else like that. I haven't minded it. I think at first I minded it, but now in hindsight, I got so much done because I was locked at home and not on tour. That I actually kind of love this. Like, I don't love COVID, but I'm like, oh man, like this was nice to be told, like, yo, you know what? Actually, while you're home, stay there.
Yeah.
Learn how to do something productive inside of the, you know, the confines of your home.
Yeah, for sure.
So I'm okay with it. It's not too crazy. I mean, there are some people who are like absolutely insane outside, but you'll get those everywhere.
For sure. I mean, I guess it's the same here. I mean, obviously everyone's wearing masks. I mean, here, I live in Huntington Beach. We're like the most we're essentially the Florida of the West Coast. It's fucking embarrassing. there's like more morons per capita in Orange County than I thought. I didn't know. I was unaware. Everyone's wearing masks. Like, restaurants are closed inside right now. You know, we're about to go into like another lockdown again where like non-essential businesses will be closed. Everyone's mad about it. And I just keep being like, I don't fucking care. Let's do whatever the fuck we got to do so that my life can come back one day.
Yeah.
Everyone's like,
yeah,
you know,
at
like,
this point, dude, at this point, I'm just like, I don't care what the hell we have to do. Can we just hurry up and do it already so that I can go, I can do something now?
For sure. Because I've loved it as well. Like, I've gotten to spend more concentrated time with my wife and kids than I have in years and years and years. I mean, we've never been a band that toured for like, fucking, you know, 11 months out of the year, but we tour a fucking lot, so being gone is being gone. So being home has been nice, but again, too, we've also made a fucking record and had time in the studio. I've started doing this, like this is a lot of what I do, and it's obviously good for multiple reasons, but for my mental, it's great too, because the connection is, I would say, almost closer than it is even in real life to some of these people that we talk to, like on stream and off stream. And like, I mean, I named a bunch of names that are people like, you know, Tormaz, Elwin, Dave, Necro, Ford, like all these people that are in the stream. Like, we chat all the time. We're like in our little Discord and we're doing the whole thing. So like the connection has been dope. And now, obviously, we went through like a big like lineup change and some bullshit like that. So we couldn't do nothing for a long time. We were very like hush hush. And now we're able to do like some live stream shit. We did one a couple weeks ago. We have one on Friday. And it's like, now we're actually kind of getting more active, but you know, it was kind of nice to, for a long time, just be like, just be, you know,
it's honestly not that bad, man. Like, I think for everyone at first, like, it gets kind of crazy, but when you actually start doing stuff, you kind of start to like appreciate what you have at home a little more.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it just, I feel like I definitely 180% needed this.
Yeah.
Because we're a small band, we have to tour a lot.
Yeah.
Because there's no way for us to build any fan base from home. And I know people are always like, oh my God, like, you don't need to tour anymore because you can build a fan base online. And even though that's true,
it's
still kind of like, yeah, there's no connection there. So you'll build like an online presence, but that doesn't translate into
No, and that doesn't translate into dollars.
It doesn't translate unless... playing for people and doing things for people. So
yeah, well, that's the thing too, is even on a smaller level, you have to realize that, like, we did the same thing where, like, I remember we were on tour, Hell or High Water was on tour, we did like, I want to say it was like 6 weeks, it was like 2 weeks out to a tour with that band Nothing More. We're on tour with Nothing More. We were on the way out and I was like, we got another offer to go out with this band to do a co-headline tour with this band called Stitched Up Heart, and I didn't know much about them. I knew they weren't big. I knew we weren't big. But it was like, they think that it'll do decent. We'll see how it goes. And it was like, our management was like, it'll keep you on tour. You have a record out. It'll keep you on the road, whatever. And we're like, cool, let's go do it. What people don't realize is, like, you go somewhere, and if there's fucking 30 people in the room and you rip all their fucking heads off and they all buy merch, the next time you go there, there's 80 people in the room. And the next time you go there, like, we played some random ass headline show in fucking like Connecticut somewhere. What's that shithole venue in Hartford?
Oh, is it the Webster?
The Webster, the small room at the Webster with the
bars. Yeah. Isn't it crazy how the moment you said that, I was like, I know exactly what venue.
It's like one of the few venues you play where they're like, yo, don't walk around.
Yeah.
And you're like,
don't go outside, man. Like,
oh, I'm gonna go to the liquor store. Like, yeah, maybe don't do that. We played this random ass show. It was the night before New York, and there was like 50 people, but we did like $26 a head in merch. Every single person bought merch. Everyone at the show. It was bananas. And the promoter was like, I knew the show was going to do exactly what it did. He goes, come back in 6 months and there'll be three times as many people here. He's like, it's just you. But if you don't play and you don't have that real connection with people, the build doesn't happen. That's why, like, touring is important. Like, we have new music to put out, but we're really strategizing when and how we're going to do it based on the fact of if we can play shows again.
Yeah, we got really lucky with that. So we recorded 19 songs. Yeah. With 19 songs, and we split it. So we put some on an EP and some on, I guess, whatever would be our next, the next thing that we put out.
Yeah.
And the goal from the beginning was, hey, use this EP to build as much as we can online so that if shows can come back, we didn't waste everything. We still have something here so that we can put it out and get you guys back on the road and do everything else. So, like, I totally understand that, man.
For sure. It's real, man. Touring is real. You got to fucking do it. The whole point of that thing, though, is the Stitch Apart. We were out, and I was like, oh, hey, babe, we got another tour offer. She's like, when is it? I'm like, 6 days after I get home. They're like, how long is it? I'm like, 4 weeks. She's like, son of a bitch. I was like, well, we got to go back on tour. But it's true.
You got to do it, man. You got to continue. You got to continuously grind.
Even as a established band, when Atreyu, we were on hiatus and we first came back, and it was we were like, oh, we're just going to tour like a little bit, like 2 weeks at a time, blah, blah, blah. And we did that for like 6 months. And we were like, no, nah, this sucks. We need to do this more. Like, it's just better. It's just not as good. It just doesn't work as good. You know?
Nah,
if you're playing bigger shows that are like sold out or whatever, it's like, it just doesn't work as good. I keep looking at myself with this hair, and in my head, it's real.
Yeah.
In my head, I have long, dope hair again.
Yeah, you're gonna get off of this and then start like feeling around like, oh my God, where'd my hair go?
Where did it go? Somebody clipped, my homie Ford clipped the
fucking, oh yeah, I saw it.
Magic. Hold on, I'm gonna watch this high five.
Yeah,
I'm watching this real fast. Hold on.
That's tight.
Hi. This is my wife, Ashley.
So sick. Hello. It's nice to meet you too.
This fool sounds like Michael Jackson. Yeah. Hell yeah.
Thanks, she did. That's crazy. It goes, she high fives the wig back on me.
You like my hair?
Oh, she did call the interview elegant. That's tight. I feel fancy now.
Yeah, I feel so fancy. Like, now I'm just like, oh, bougie.
I am drinking white wine during the day. So I won't keep you that much longer. I do want to ask, this is B-Sal Presents What Else. What is Joey Tyler's What Else? What else are you into? What else do you do? I love to cook. Obviously, I have kids. I paint. I'd say cooking and painting are my two other like biggest like hobbies, passions. What do you do? What do you love?
All right. Well, I like to eat. Dude, you can't put food in front of me because I will eat the shit out of it. I wouldn't even ask what it is. I'll just eat it.
Yep.
I eat a lot. I play like a crap ton of video games. And then I spend the rest of my day trying to explain to my daughter why she shouldn't do any of the things she does because I already did that in life and it's not going to work out better.
How old is
your
daughter?
So those are my three hobbies. She is 13.
Oh, dude. It's okay. So I have a four-year-old. She'll be four in January. And then I have a two-and-a-half-year-old. She was born in June. I'm not even close to where you are yet, but I'm already to the like, Why?
Dude, it's the weirdest thing ever. She asked me yesterday at what age she can have a boyfriend. And before I got to answer, she goes, there's a boy I have a crush on. And I'm immediately like, there's
she's not
a what
asking
that you,
you
what?
She's not asking you what age she can have a boyfriend. She's asking you, I have a boyfriend. Is that cool?
Yeah. Also, I in my head, I'm like, you're in school online. How are you meeting people? Like, there's a computer in front of you. You're not going outside.
Well, I mean, bro, but I don't know in your age, but in my age, in my youth, that's how I met my wife on the internet. I met my wife in like
really?
Chat rooms on like, this is pre-MySpace. This is like Face the Jury and like talking on MySpace. You leave those super hinting fucking away messages and you're like, you're hitting that ASL. Like,
oh yeah, that was like the AOL chat.
Picks question mark. You know what I mean? Like that's how I met girls when I was young. That's how I met my wife. So it's like,
dude, that's crazy.
You know, they're talking. I'm horrified. I just thought about both my kids being teenagers and it just got, I think I'm a
dude. I didn't, you know, what's funny. I never thought about it until it happened. And then I always thought, I was like, well, you know what? My daughter, I'm like, maybe she'll come out like her mom and she'll be great. But she came out like me, and so now I'm like, well, I remember what I was like when I was younger, so this is incredibly terrifying, super terrifying. But
see, me and my wife were both, like, good kids. Like, my wife was way more good than me, but, like, I'm still mischievous. I was just mischievous when I was a kid. And I still am. But like, dude, you know, it is what it is. I think there could be, I think it's like, oh, my kids would be good. But those teenage years, it's like, you really, especially this day and age, like 13 is not what 13 was when we were growing up. Like 13 is like 17, 18 now. And you're like, whoa, like you see kids and you're like, oh, that kid's like, that kid's like 17. You're like, no, that kid's 12. You're like,
yeah. Huh? Dude, it also doesn't help that like my, so she watches me do all this stuff. She absolutely loves this. Like she's kind of like, she likes to show it off. She's like, oh, my daddy's like a rock star or whatever. And I'm like, you should probably stop saying that. But she sees me do all this stuff. And then like, I try to tell her to not do things. And her response is, but you do it. And I don't have a response back because I do it. It's
like, you're like, yeah, but I'm an adult. Shut up.
Yeah, it's like, well, I don't have a response, but you know, I'm dad. And so you can't say that. You can't speak back to me. So now you're punished. Yeah. For reminding me that I do bad shit. That's just the way it works.
I'm taking away your computer. Well, you can't because that's how I go to school. Damn it.
Yeah, dude, you can't even take away the computer now because it's crazy. The world is crazy.
We have this dilemma because like our kids, you know, like I said, 4 and 2.5. We have an iPad, but they don't have their own like technology. Gotcha. They didn't touch a phone until they were like each 2. You know what I mean? So we don't let them like sit and hold a phone. Like if we're at a restaurant or something and we're trying to like have a nice chill meal or something like that, we'll put up like the iPad or the phone and put like a show or a movie, but they can't like hold shit in their hand because I feel like that's like that one cross line where it becomes obsessive. But we have this like dilemma where we're like, but they're going to need to know technology because that's what school is these days. Like school, you're on an iPad, you're on your phone, you're using apps, you're using a computer, all these things. So it's fucking crazy. My wife's like, I'm dying. She's probably in the living room crying right now because of this conversation.
Dude, but it's, I mean, I would be dying too if I was listening to all the crap that I was saying. But I mean, it's true. It's like, this is the world. Like sometimes I think about trying to limit her technology. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, maybe you should, you know, when you're not doing classes, maybe, I don't know, do anything else for like a couple of hours.
Yeah.
But then it's kind of like, is that really going to help? Because she's probably just going to find a way to steal it anyway. And just go do it anyway.
And like,
that's
as
all
you're,
I did.
And like, as you're telling her, you're like sending a, you're like posting on Twitter. Just like do anything else. Just like for a couple hours.
Dude, she called me out on that the other day. So the other day I don't even remember what we were talking about, but I pointed out that sometimes I speak to her and she'll start speaking and she'll zone out. She'll look at her phone and just completely lose track of everything. And as I was pointing it out to her, she was responding and she goes, hey, dad. And I look and she goes, you just did that same thing to me right now as you were doing it. And it was because I was on my phone answering back an email. And again, I was like, I got no response.
So, like I'm working.
I got nothing.
Yeah. My family, you know, my kids, my daughters just hit my phone out of my hand. If I'm like looking at something, like whatever, they'll just walk up and be like, pfft. And I'm like, touche.
Yeah. I just cry myself to sleep every night now, thinking of how much a parental failure I am. It's like, God, I suck at this.
I don't think any parents are failures. I think everyone just has their own journey. My wife just said, you do what works for you and your family. That's the only thing that's important. Good parenting is subjective. Huh. Obviously, like if you don't like feed your kids and you like hit them or you like neglect them, you're a bad parent. But other than that, everyone's a good parent as long as you're just fucking trying your best. All we can do is try your best.
Yeah, I try to do the I'm your parent, but also I want to teach you like real life kind of stuff approach because no one taught me any of the stuff that I know now. I learned it all by myself. And so I try to tell her, hey, before you go out and do it, I'll tell you what's going to happen if you do this. If you do it anyway, at least I warned you.
At least I told you. Yeah, and then when I tell what's going to happen happens, I'll be like, I told you.
That's the only thing you could do at this point.
I'm saying, dude, I started touring. I turned 18 on my first tour. I started touring since I was 17 years old, and I haven't stopped. So, like, straight out of high school, I went on tour and learned to do everything on tour in a van with no money, taking care of myself, doing shit that I like. You know, there was no supervision. You know what I mean? So it's I mean, it's just one of those things. But this is what it is. They'll either listen or they won't.
It's crazy, man. I go on tour sometimes and she always asks me, like, hey, what do you do on tour? And I was like, you know, I sit at the bar, I drink, and then I play a show. I don't really do anything on tour.
My wife just posted a quote from herself. She said, I'm an okay mom. I don't do meth, so there's that.
I'm going to start saying that to everyone now.
I don't do meth.
I don't do meth, so there's that.
There's that, yeah. I've never, you know, passed out when I wasn't supposed to.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
You know, as long as I wasn't face down on the ground in exactly. front of my child, exactly. I'm an okay parent.
I love it.
That's all the words. Funny, man.
That's great. Well, dude, it's been a pleasure to talk to you, man. Up until today, I'd never spoken to you before, never met you. You're very, very easy to talk to. Very cool, dude. Do you have anything that you want to shout out and promote? I think one of your dudes in the band, so you guys are doing a Twitch, like a listening live stream coming up.
Yeah, we're doing. So we got a record coming out on Friday. It's our debut EP on Spine Farm. It's called Cloud City, and we're going to do like a listening party on my guitarist's Twitch account, which he's somewhere like in the comments and stuff. Mm-hmm. If you like Shameless, check it out. I don't care how you check it out, whether Spotify, you steal it from Kingdom Leaks. I honestly don't care. Just listen. You get it, you got it. Just listen to it. That's all that matters to me.
And if you have Octane, you're fucking hearing it. I guarantee you. You're hearing it.
maybe you're hearing it.
Yep, you're definitely fucking hearing that song. That's awesome,
dude,
man.
This was sick. I needed this. I really needed this.
Hell yeah. Well, dude, I'm glad you had a good time. I appreciate you. I wish you guys.